And so with safer streets, with great local schools, with fantastic broadband, forgive me.
Okay, so we've made it to Easter. At least if you're watching this, we have. I'm recording this slightly in advance. And I think we're probably all looking forward to taking a little break. It's definitely been a challenging term. You know, in many ways, we're still in the middle of this pandemic. So many ways. Believe it or not, 688 of you have tested positive since September. Huge numbers. And that's been true of colleagues too. And people have had to lean on each other. And we've all been out of position now for quite a while. And inevitably, there's a lot of talk about mental health, you know, issues there and, you know, about stress. So I guess what I'd like to talk to you about at this Easter assembly, if I may, is recovery. This break that we're going into, I want to talk to you about recovery, active recovery. And I think it's really important. Because I think all of us, just to a greater or lesser degree, are experiencing, you know, some stress, some mental health issues, and I think we're all in it, really. Now, what I'm probably not talking about, just to be very clear, is a mental health illness that's been diagnosed by a healthcare professional. That's slightly different. And for that, you're going to need professional advice. And that will be a small minority. I'm talking to the majority now, all of us. And it will be a factor and a feature of your life all the way. You know, we all experience stress. It's just totally, it is in many ways very natural. Now, if I give you a simple example, although you probably wouldn't believe it to look at me, I have been going to the gym at school with Mr. Bromley and, you know, some students, although I haven't been doing very well in the last few weeks, I'm happy to admit. Now, in the gym, we're lifting weights. We're putting stress on our body. And in this sense, here, stress is actually good for me. This is the type of stress that I need. Now, because I don't go regularly enough, I do have to take breaks. I have to take days off in between. And if I go a bit too often, I actually get quite sore. If I next week decided to go to the gym every single day, maybe even twice a day, that stress would become too much. What would happen? I'd get injured, right? I'll be injured because I haven't recovered. I haven't recovered from the session. And I feel that in our day-to-day lives at the moment, all of us, we're not recovering. It's not necessarily the stress that's the problem. It's that we're not getting enough time to recover. Now, even within my own lifetime, which may seem like a long time ago for you guys, but there were no mobile phones. You've heard this before. In Ireland, there weren't even that many TV stations, to be honest. And it wasn't really an option to kind of be constantly on like that. It just wasn't something that we could do. You were out and about on your bike, you were outdoors, you were exercising. It was just a more natural way. And I mean, if we go back even further, say like go back 100 years and, you know, you're in rural Britain. I mean, lots of places wouldn't have even had electricity after a certain hour. So people would come home from, you know, whatever they were doing. And the light, you know, the lights might have been off. You know, if there was a light, it was certainly not on all night. And, you know, it was candles and it was, you know, you just naturally switched off. human beings switched off. It became dark. And of course, that's just not true today at all. Everything's on all the time. And as a result, we're not recovering. And I think this is particularly true of you guys, to be honest, because, you know, school would be full on. We'd have, we'd be asking you to do quite a lot here. Then you don't get the chance to just completely switch off. You know, a lot of your life is controlled. You're always busy. And when you need that break, when your brain has had too much in the gym, if you like, you're stressed. What we're doing, how is it helping us to recover? If you're immediately onto your phone, if there's been a stressful relationship issue or something like that, and it carries on when you go home, it carries on maybe even all night. Maybe you're taking the phone to bed with you. So it's 24 hours, this stress for some people. And that is going to lead to mental health problems. There's just, it's just common sense. It's common sense. So we have to actually do something about this. You know, we have to become active in our recovery. And there are just simple things you can do. It is really, it doesn't have to be complicated. I mean, number one, exercise. You know, get out on your bike over Easter. Get out for a walk. Get out for a run. Some of you are fantastic with the sports and all the clubs that you get involved in. Keep all that going. It's so important and it's so good for your mental health. Like, it will make you happy. Positive relationships. Positive relationships. You know, if you're spending good time with your peers who are going through the same stuff, it's done in a positive way. That's so good for you. So good for your stress, myself included. You know, just hanging out with friends, family. These things are just so important for us, and you have to value it, and you have to make time for it. That is not the same as going on social media and having some sort of virtual, you know, God knows what. That's not the same. Yeah, that's not going to give you the same benefits of recovery. Just simple things that we can do to recover. So I'm talking about exercise. I'm talking about positive relationships. Another thing you can do is like this, just simple meditative things, you know, like just maybe even listening to music for 5 minutes or just sitting quietly for a few minutes. It doesn't have to be rocket science. I know some of you are into gymnastics and you'll do kind of proper like yoga style exercises. All that type of thing is fantastic for you. You know, mindfulness, that will really help you, you know, if you're feeling really overwhelmed. Another simple thing that you can do, is just do the whole grateful thing. You know, everybody talks about that. So, I mean, one exercise, that they do, lots of psychologists talk about this, but you can talk about just being thankful. You know, what am I really happy about? And if you sat down and did that, you know, 3 things every day, and if you did that for 3 weeks, that can like rewire your brain. You know, that can just make you feel happier, healthier. So exercise, positive relationships, something like music, meditation, and gratitude. You know, if you just did those 4 things, it would really help you with your mental health. And then finally, just this break itself. You know, if I talk about myself, I tested positive for COVID, believe it or not, on Christmas Eve. So that Christmas was a write-off. And I know this has just been true for, you know, almost everybody at some stage. So we haven't had those kind of natural breaks. And this Easter feels like, fingers crossed, we could get a good break. So while I know our exam classes, you'll be keen to come to school and do some of the intervention. And that is important, of course. Just do it in a balanced way, you know, because recovery is massively important too. And all these things I'm talking about that will help you to recover will make you a better student too, a better learner. So guilt-free, have a really good rest this Easter. Recover. Recover. Enjoy the assembly. I saw the fire in your eyes. I saw the fire when I look in your eyes. You told me things you don't want to try. I love to take you, it's the devil in the stars. You just get off of me alive. You don't believe yourself to me, but it's not the best. You said you did this all the time.
Gents, can you sum up your season?
Well, I think it's been very good so far. We started off slow, but we've picked up the pace, brought a few new players in from different schools and doing well.
Yeah, I think we've done very well. We've beaten most teams, yeah, we picked it up and people have stuck to their positions.
That's great, but gents, I've heard you've also played for the netball team, is that correct?
Yeah.
Fantastic. So you and your netball team have had some great results recently. What have been the keys to your success?
Probably our teamwork. And probably just our tactics altogether.
Fantastic, thank you very much. You have a key role as team assistant manager. How do you view the team's season this year?
So far this season, it's been on and off, losing, winning, winning, as you go, you know, normal season. But I can believe this season we can win. Just made it through to the semis, I heard.
So, gentlemen, top of the league, how are you feeling about this?
Obviously, finishing first in the league is an ecstatic feeling, and I think as a team we've worked really, really hard. We've had some great support from the fans, and I can't wait to hopefully bypass this semi-final and move into the final.
Same, I'm actually buzzing, I'm happy with the team, good team performance, and yeah, top of the league.
Never ever. We'll be right back. Happy Easter, everyone. Welcome to the great outdoors. Hope over the next few weeks you're going to get some time out into the fresh air, into the outside. Maybe your garden, maybe the beach, maybe the river, like me. Today I want to talk to you about fears, tears and ears. 2,000 years ago, 2,000 miles away from here, there was a 33-year-old man who walked into a garden. He had his best mates with him. They were tired, they were exhausted, they'd experienced and seen so many things. And this man knew his days on earth were limited. And he'd gone to this special garden, his favourite place, to find a bit of peace, to find a bit of hope, to take some time out. He was hoping his mates would stay with him. And as he got to the ground to pray, to cry out, fear took over him. And we all know about fear, anxiety, worries. We've all been there. They crop up out of the blue sometimes. And he experienced fear right there in this garden. So much fear, there's so much anxiety, there's so much worries. He took time out. He looked around, his mates had fallen asleep. He woke them up and said, guys, hang with me, please, hang with me. He went back and he carried on praying and he paused. And the fear was real and the fear is there. And fear's okay. We just got to get to know it. We just got to get to understand it. We need to learn the skills and the gifts to not be frightened of our fear. He woke up again from his prayers and he saw his mates asleep, these friends that were letting him down. And he started to cry tears. Tears described so much that there was like blood and sweat and tears all mixed together. And crying is a good thing. Releasing some of the pain within through one tear, two tears, is a good thing. It tells us as friends and it tells you with the friends you're around that there's something going wrong. Please help, please listen. And he cried, and he wept, and he prayed, and he got up again and realised his friends had let him down, and they were asleep still, and he woke them up, my time has come now, my time has come. It's okay to cry, it's okay to reveal what's going on inside, and this 2 weeks ahead could be a time for you just to share with someone close to you, what is that pain within, what are those fears and those worries, time to share, let the tears do the talking. So they got up and a crowd approached with flaming torches and aggression and anger in the air. And this man noticed that one of his best friends was with this crowd, with swords drawn. And he approached him, walked up to him, and he kissed him on the cheek, a traditional greeting in that part of the world. But this one wasn't of love, this was of betrayal. This was of saying, this is the one you need to arrest, this is the one you need to execute. You see, this man had preached messages of love and acceptance and justice and peace and hope, and it had got him in trouble with the religious people. It got him in trouble with the politicians, and they were out to get him. And this was the moment where his best friend betrayed him. We get let down so often. But we've looked at the fears and we've seen the tears and now the ears. His friends had woken up. And they saw this crowd and they started to arrest the man and they drew their swords and they started to have a fight. And he approached one of these guards that had come and he lopped off his ear. And the description is amazing because time stood still as this 33-year-old man put his hand on the shoulder, on the head of his enemy and said, this is not the way. Peace is the way. Violence is not the future. Peace is the way. And as he placed his hand on his head, miracle, story, who knows? But his ear, the description goes, grew back. Can you imagine that man? From 1 minute being a man of violence and anger and pain and anguish to suddenly experience peace and calm and healing as a stranger who he's come to arrest brings love and hope and healing. They took him off. And the next 24 hours is for what many people is what Easter's about. It's about a story of someone who wasn't frightened of fear, but embraced it and understood it. Who had friends who let him down, who wept tears to reveal the pain within. And then even at his moments, last moments, was able to bring love, care and compassion with that caring of touch. What a man. A lot of people have asked, who was this man? Many people still ask, who is this man? Well, Easter is the time to ask those questions. It's a time to be honest, to get outdoors, to go to your special favourite place, your garden of Gethsemane. It's a time for you to be with your friends and reveal what's going on in your life, the anxieties, the fears and the worries. Maybe it's time to pause and take stock. It's time to find some peace. Time to find some healing. I hope you do have the most amazing Easter. A time to be together, to find peace, hope, and ultimately, love. Knowing that you're loved and finding someone to love. Have an amazing Easter, everyone. Take care. God bless.
Great, so we've reached the end. Nothing left for me to do other than declare the Principal's Award. This time I am actually going for three because I just feel like we've missed a few along the way. So firstly, we're going for Melissa Fellingham. Well done, Melissa. I think you've somehow managed to get through 5 years of secondary school without a single negative point, which is pretty remarkable, I have to say. Megan Brattle, well done to you too. Exactly the same, you know, incredible. Brought nothing but positivity and your A game to school every day for all that time. Pretty impressive. And we're also going for Ethan Bryant Smith. Well done, Ethan. You're attitude to your studies and life in general has been fantastic and infectious, and lots of teachers slipped your name to me this time as well. So well done to you three. You shall be immortalized on the Principal's Award board. Well done. Listen, everyone, have a great Easter. Behave yourselves. You continue to represent us even in the holidays. Be safe and have a really happy Easter. All the best. Bye-bye.
Easter Bunny.
Pepper and her friends have come to Rebecca Rabbit's house for an Easter egg hunt.
Hello, Rebecca.
Hello, everyone.
Are you looking forward to the egg hunt?
Yes.
Ready, steady, go.
Wait, stop, stop.
What?
You can't start. The Easter Bunny hasn't been to hide the eggs yet.
Oh.
When is the Easter Bunny getting here?
Very soon.
Good. We'll wait.
Hands up anybody who's been to Peppa Pig World. Not enough. I was a bit hazy what I would find at Peppa Pig World, but I loved it. And Peppa Pig World is very much my kind of place.